If you're just visiting us, we're in a series looking at psalms that have a past. That is, we know the historical context of them. And today, we're going to look at one that has exactly that. It has a little thing at the beginning of the psalm that actually tells us where it comes from. And in the Hebrew Bible, the psalms include this little historical reference at the top as verse 1. We kind of push it out to verse 0, and verse 1 is actually what the song is. But today, we're going to look at Psalm 142. So you can turn there, and we'll look at that in just a second. But always, before we read the psalm, we have to look at the circumstance that he's in. And if you understand the circumstance, it radically changes how you read the song later on. Because certain things catch your eye that would not normally catch your eye, because you know what it is David's going through. So we are currently, we're only, I think, number four. Yeah, four in the series. There's 13 of these. So we're still pretty early. We're going chronologically in the life of David. We're still pretty early in the life of David. He's not king yet. He has been anointed by Samuel to be king, but he's not king yet, and King Saul is still the king, and King Saul still hates his guts. He's jealous of David because David had become so popular, starting with the killing of Goliath and then some, really military stuff. Saul's still mad at him, so mad at him that he has chased him all the way across the country, out of the country, and David is running for his life, literally. Running for his life, literally. Now, if you know David also, you also know that David will soon become king, but it's hard to tell when based on this narrative for him because he's just running and he's running for his life. But you also know that David's a singer. In fact, he's called the sweet singer of Israel in another place. So David's a singer, so in the places that he finds himself, he is prone to write songs. And those songs are the Psalms. Almost, not all of them, but a huge chunk of the Psalms say right at the top in attribution, a psalm of David. Well, it's just a song. And they were collected together in a songbook, and people would sing these words. So these are his lyrics written in the real life experiences that he was in. And today we'll look at that real life experience. So let me just catch up. At the top of this psalm, it says, this is the only clue we have, a maskil of David. And maskil, we're not exactly sure what that means. We think it means like a poem or a prayer. A maskil of David. When he was in the cave, a prayer. And that's all we know. Well, we know in the life of David, when you read through 1 Samuel, while he's running from Saul, he's in caves a couple times. And in fact, we'll have another psalm coming up in a few weeks that says pretty much the same thing. He's in a cave. But based on the context and the content of the psalm, we got a pretty good guess that Psalm 142 is going to be from where we're going to look at in a second. So we look for a case in the narrative of David's life where there's a cave, and that first cave is in 1 Samuel 22. So we're going to go there first. We're going to get an idea about what this whole cave thing is all about, and then we'll look at the song that he wrote as a result of that experience. Okay? So let me catch up. Last week, we saw how David had run off to the enemies, to the Philistines, and the Philistines... King is Achish, and he's presented in front of Achish. He's held captive there, and all the servants of Achish want to kill David. And then David does this thing where he starts drooling and acting like a madman. And so Achish looks at him and says, "Hey, behold, you see the man behaving as a madman? Why do you bring him to me?" says the king. "Do I lack madmen that you brought this one to act the madman in my presence? Shall this one come into my house?" So basically he says, "Don't we have enough idiots in the Philistines? I don't need another idiot. Get rid of him." And in another psalm, it actually says that Achish drove him out. I mean, which means he literally escorted him to the edge of the Philistine Empire. That's how much he didn't want to have another idiot in his house. Don't I have enough madmen as it is? Get rid of him. So he actually drives him out. This is the sworn enemy of Israel. Drives David out as he's feigning this madness. And the very next words we see is this in 1 Samuel 22:1. "So David departed from there and escaped to the cave of Adullam." So that's where we are today. We're in the cave of Adullam. And to give you a little bit of geography, these are real places. Here's a picture of Israel. North is up, so that we got that big blue thing on the right. That's the Dead Sea. And going up above the Dead Sea is the Jordan River Valley. And that goes up to the Sea of Galilee, which is off the map to the top. But I wanted to put this up because I wanted to illustrate something. This is a relief map that tells you altitude. The yellow part right there is the highest part of Israel. And it's like a ridge that runs north-south through Israel. And that's where God told the Israelites to live. He said, "I want you to live right here. Now, you own all this land, but I really want you to reside right here on this top part." And part of God's reasoning was this. He says, when you live there and you grow your crops up there on the high parts, the only way you're going to have water to water your plants is if I bring it to you by rain and by dew. So I want you to be dependent on me. So he tells them, you own all of this, really, but this is the place where I want you to depend on me. So at this time in the story, the Philistines are still in the land, and they occupy the lowland that's off to the left. So here's Jerusalem on the top of the highland right there. Here's where the Philistines live, down here on the coast. The Philistines are known to us as being a sailing bunch of people like the Phoenicians. So they were used to traveling by water, which is why they're there. So they're close. They're in the lowlands of the coast down there. Actually, present-day Gaza, you hear about the Gaza Strip, is right down here, down this lower part, or right on the coast. So there's the Philistines. They've occupied pretty much this low ground. And they have been a real pain to Israel for a long time. You remember back in Judges? When you read back in Judges, the Philistines are there, and when you see Samson is fighting who? The Philistines, way back when. And when David and Goliath is of the Philistines are there, and the Philistines are still here. In fact, what the Philistines would love to do, I hadn't planned on doing this, they would love to come up and take the high ground where Jerusalem is and all the rest of Israel. If they can come up to this high ground, then they can actually conquer Israel, but as long as they stay in the low ground, they're not conquering Israel. And there's river valleys that run up from the coast and come up to Jerusalem right here. Three principal ones are part of the stories you read about. When you read about Samson is in the Sorek Valley. Well, that's one of the river valleys that comes up right here that leads right up to Jerusalem right there. When David fights Goliath, he fights him in the valley of Elah. Well, Elah is another valley just below the Sorek Valley that comes up right here. And there's also the Ayalon Valley up here. So there's three principal river valleys. And through the entire history with the Philistines keep trying to push their way up and push their way up. And as they're pushing their way up with a little boy named David with a sling, that's the last defensible ground the Israelites have. If they get past him, they'll come right up the Elah Valley and come right up and capture Israel. So that's the defense places. So that's where we're at today. And he's run actually down to there. Israel is in this basic yellow area at this time. They've sort of retreated to the high ground, and that's really the heart of Israel. So last week we saw that the kingdom of the Philistines, the capital is Gath. David had come from Nob, where the priests were, which is just north of Jerusalem, and had gone there and gone down to Gath to find refuge with his enemies. Craziest thing in the world. And he's carrying, as a billboard, the sword of Goliath. So they spot him pretty fast. After that episode, and when he's pushed out by Achish, who says, get out, I don't need any more madmen, David goes backwards, and he goes up to here, which is where Adullam is, which is kind of in the no man's land between those two kingdoms. It's far enough away from the Philistines that the Philistines aren't going to follow him, probably. It's not far enough into Saul's kingdom that people will spot him and say, we know where David is. So the cave of Adullam is actually connected right off the edge of the valley of Elah. So David himself is running away from the Philistines down the very valley that he conquered Goliath, took a right turn just before he goes up the hill, and he's in a cave in Adullam. So that's where he is. He's in like no man's land. He's not part of the Philistines. He's really not part of Israel. And he's all alone, and he's stuck in this cave, which is safe. But in a real sense, it's like being in a prison for him. So what do you do now? You can't go back to Israel, because Saul will kill you. You can't go to the Philistines, because they would kill you, because you can only get away with that feigning madness thing once. So what you do is you sit in between, and you sit in a hole in the ground. And that's the context of today's psalm. You sit in this hole in the ground, you sit in this cave, and what do you think about? The isolation. There's nobody there. You are temporarily safe, but is this your future? Is this the future for you, to sit in a cave until Saul the king is dead, and then you can go out and become king? So put yourself in his shoes, being in a dark, extremely lonely place. I mean, no one there to encourage you. You're all alone. You're all by yourself. You're sitting in a cave, and you're tempted to go through this woe is me syndrome. I have no home. I can't go back to Israel. They'll kill me. I can't go back to the Philistines. They wanted to kill us all along. I mean, I have no place. The only place I have now is a hole in the ground. So I think depressing, confined, lonely, hopeless. And you'll be in the right mindset for Psalm 142. Okay, so here we go. Let's see what it says. Psalm 142, I've kind of chopped it in half. The first half of it is where he says, here I am. And he'll describe what he's all about, what's going on. That's always okay. And then the second half, he'll say, here I pray. So he starts off with, here I am. And then he says, here I pray. So he's going to start with this context, where he's at. He's going to tell God straight up, this is what's going down. And then the second half, he'll pray. So we get to look into his heart in all of this. So let's start with this first half. Here I am. How does he describe his circumstance? And he starts off Psalm 142 by saying it just like this. He says, I cry aloud with my voice to the Lord. I make supplication with my voice to the Lord. I pour out my complaint before him, and I declare my trouble before him. So what does David do while he's sitting in the cave? He complains to God. Now, you know, if I was going to write an uber godly song, I wouldn't put in the front of it, hey, God, life stinks. I hate this. This is wrong. I don't like this. But in the Psalms where we see David in a real context, that's how he always starts. He doesn't gloss over his situation. He comes to God and says, okay, I got a beef, and my beef is where I am right now. And this is how things are going. So instead of just sitting there and, you know, yelling at the walls, he cries out to God. Yeah, but out loud. I mean, the words actually tell us. He's saying this stuff out loud in the middle of the cave, with it all reverberating inside the cave. God, this is horrible. But he not only cries aloud with a voice, he makes a supplication. What's a supplication? I hate big religious words. I don't want to use the word supplication all week long. You ask for something. In English, it's connected to the word supply. So what you're saying is, God, supply me. I'm asking for something here. So not only does he complain, but he asks God to come in and provide something to supply for situation. That's always a really good thing to do. It's always bad to just complain and never expect anything from God or ask him for anything. But complain, that's okay. And then say, but God, you need to supply what you can bring to my situation. I'm looking to you. That's my supplication. So it's really not a bad 1-2 punch. If you're in a bad situation, and we all have been or will be or are in a bad situation, there's nothing ungodly about telling God that you don't like it. There's nothing wrong with that at all. But go to step B and say, but God, that's why I'm crying to you. Will you supply my situation with what you can bring to it? So that's his supplication. He pours out his complaint and he declares his trouble. So he's laid it out. Said, okay, God, if you're going to supply to help me, let me tell you how you can help me, because I'll tell you what's wrong right now. Number one, I don't have a homeland to go back to. Number two, there's no one with me. I'm really lonely. Number three, I don't have any food except for the rest of those 5 loaves that I got from the priest at the Nabu, you know, but I don't know how long those are lasting. I've got all these needs, and here I am stuck in this hole. As far as anyone else in the universe is concerned, I don't exist because I'm in this hole all by myself. That's my complaint. God, you need to come to my aid. Okay? So then he goes on. Verse 3, still part of the here I am stuff. When my spirit was overwhelmed within me, you knew my path in the way where I walk. They've hidden a trap for me. So his spirit is overwhelmed. It's a great translation. It's the same word as you'd have if you step off a commercial cruise liner in the middle of the ocean and you jumped into the sea. You would be overwhelmed. And that's the whole metaphor he's trying to say. It's as though I just stepped off a boat and I'm sinking deep. And I'm completely overwhelmed. There's no way I can tread water here. I'm way in over my depth. And that's really what he's saying. My whole spirit inside is overwhelmed. But, and this is a peak, the glimmer of hope, but you knew my path. I mean, you've seen. It's not like I'm telling you something you don't know, God. But I just want to reiterate to you how I feel. This is how I feel. So part B, when you pray to God in a tough situation, it's not wrong to complain. It's not wrong to say you don't like the situation. When someone says, how's it going? You don't have to say, oh, it's okay. You don't. I mean, we're in bad situations. Complain to God. Bring your complaint to God. Ask him to supply. And tell him what your heart's going through. Tell him, I'm overwhelmed. I don't have what it takes inside to weather through this. My spirit is overwhelmed. And that's okay to tell God too. I'm in way over my head. And he says why it's overwhelmed him. In the way where I walk, they've hidden a trap for me. He says basically, everywhere I go now, as I walk, there are people out there who are stalking me. They're planning where I'm going to walk next, and they're laying traps for me. Now, what's terrifying about that statement is you never see the trap, but you know they're laying it for you. And the traps are deliberately designed so that you can't see them ahead of time. So David is saying, metaphorically and in reality, he's saying, listen, if I go out there and just walk among the living, they know where I am. They've set traps for me. They're gonna grab me. And I can't see where they are because that's the nature of traps. The nature of traps is that they're deliberately hidden from your view. But who sees them? You know my path. So in a sense, he's saying at the same time, you know, this is why I'm in over my head. If I go out there, I will not be able to see far enough ahead to be able to tell where the traps are. And yet there are people deliberately aimed in their day today when they woke up to lay a trap to grab me. But God, you see my path. Now, let me extend this back for a second. In our lives right now, I don't have anyone that lays traps for me. Do you? Does anyone here? I haven't fallen on recently. But Paul tells us we don't battle with flesh and blood. There's a spiritual battle that goes on right now around you. And Satan is active, and he has a bunch of beings that follow him, we call demons. They're actively in pursuit of you. They know where you're prone to walk based on what you know you like to do and not like to do, and they'll lay traps for you. And I'm not kidding. This is real life. This is what real temptation is all about from that spiritual perspective. So don't be too complacent. You live in the midst of a spiritual battle that goes on, and traps are being carefully laid for you all the time. And when you wake up in the morning not realizing that, then you're a sitting duck.
It's like them saying, God, our Satan is in the mind reader, but he sure knows where we've been.
That's exactly right. And he knows you. And we're told, Peter says, he prowls about like a lion. I mean, he's actually stalking you. So make no mistake. And by the way, these traps and this stalking from Satan are largely in the realm of what you believe. Satan is the father of lies. So he will try and lay a trap for you with a lie that'll make you believe the wrong thing, so much so that he gets you to actively and willingly participate in your own destruction because you believe the lie. And that's what lies do. So that's how you're being stalked right now. Just to let you know, that's what's going on. So you got to be up on that. And instead of saying the next morning you wake up, well, today I'm going to be smarter than Satan. I'm going to see those traps and I'm going to navigate them. And if you do that, he's already caught you. So the issue is you've got to look to God and say, God, they lay traps for me, which means I can't see them. They're deliberately designed for me not to see them. Will you protect me today as I walk? This is your job, not mine. You see my path, so walk ahead of me. And the psalmist says that God walks ahead of us. He's our forward guard, and he's also our rear guard. He watches ahead and watches behind. So God, this is an active battle we're in. So every time we talk about this, extend it to the spiritual dimension. There's more going on than meets the eye. So they've hidden a trap for me. He continues his here I am. This is how he closes out his here I am, in fact. He says, look to the right and see. There's no one who regards me. Which is his way of saying, look, I look to my right, and there's nobody there. I think he's in the cave. He's doing this. I look to my right, there's no one there. And the right actually is it's a powerful statement. The right, who is on your right, is the person who engages in strength on your behalf. If you just measure your right hand and your left hand, metaphorically, sorry you left-handers here, but if you have the right hand is always seen as the hand of power, that's the hand that holds the sword. So the people who stand on your right are the ones who engage in might on your behalf. The active executive of that power. So he says, look, I look to those who would engage on my behalf, and there's nobody there. I'm all alone. And this is where you get to the lonely aspect of being in the cave. I look to my right. There's no one who regards me. In fact, literally that second phrase, I looked in the Hebrew, it says, there's no one, period. I looked to my right, there's no one. It's his way of saying metaphorically, no one is on my side, God. Nobody. There's just nobody here. How am I supposed to defend myself against the entire military might of Israel and the military might of the Philistines? I got nobody. I got nothing like an army. And he used to have an army. You know, when he worked for Saul, he was a general that had lots of guys at his command. And now he looks to his right, there's nobody. I look to my right and see. He's asking God to do this. Okay, God, look. Look to my right and see. See anybody? There's nobody. And then he says, there's no escape for me. No one cares for my soul. This is the end of his here I am statement, basically, because he's saying, I have no one who's advocating for me or who's engaging on my behalf for my good. And not only that, I don't really have an escape. I mean, I've got a hole in the cave. I could go out there, but that's no escape because that's actually to get taken by the two factions that are out to kill me. I don't have an escape. My only freedom is this stupid cave. I'm actually in bondage is what it is. I have no escape. No one cares for my soul. When people tell that to me, I go, you're such a whiner. Well, this really caught my attention. So I looked at this word cares for my soul, this care right here, and it's a little more complicated than that. It means literally to seek someone out with care. So for instance, if someone who's a good close friend of yours, you normally would see them say once a week, say maybe at church or something like that. And then all of a sudden they stop showing up, and then you don't see them very much anymore. And you start to worry about, well, I wonder if something happened to them, right? Well, since you're a good close friend, what you would do is you would seek them out with care. It's the whole idea of going to someone and finding out if they're okay. It's the same thing to inquire into someone or actually to look in on someone, or in the modern day equivalent, doctors don't make house calls, but in this case they do. It's a house call. You know, no one, what David is saying is no one is looking in on me and trying to find where I am. Here I am all alone, desolate, no one on my right, and no one's even looking for me to care for me. I'm completely forgotten, and nobody cares. How comes no one's knocking on the door of my cave saying, hey, David, you okay? And he's saying, there's nobody like that. No one's seeking me. Who cares for me? Now, this happens to me when I get a little depressed when my circumstances get bad. You know, your circumstances get bad. You tell yourself you're all alone in your circumstance. And then you actually, now, you know, back off if you've never done this, but I've done this sometimes. You start to say to yourself, how comes no one's coming to find out how I am? Where's my friends? Why aren't they knocking on my door? Clearly I'm showing all the signs of being in distress, but no one is looking in on me. No one cares. No one's seeking me out. And that actually makes you feel even more isolated. And that, okay, it's a little whiny, but in a reality, it's just another component to the fact that I feel so alone and I'm hurting so badly. How comes no one seems to notice and intercede on my behalf? Why doesn't anyone notice? It's a natural thing for David to think as he sits in this cave all alone. Why aren't they sending out search parties or something? Why is there no one who cares enough for me to come looking for me? How come someone hearing outside saying, David, are you there? We want to help you. No one's doing that. So he's dug himself even a deeper hole than just this cave is. He's pretty convinced that he is so uncared for, no one's looking for him. And that's what that word means. It's a deep sense of lostness because nobody cares. So now in the midst of that depression, it's time to pray. And I agree. Because if we quit right here, I'd be really depressed, actually. But I got to tell you, just think back. He's being really straight about his situation. He really is. He's telling God his heart. He's telling him how he feels. Whether it's right or wrong, this is where my heart's at as well as this is my circumstance. Tell God your circumstance and tell him where your heart's at. And tell him, I know it's probably wrong to feel this way, but doggone it, this is the way I feel because of this. I need you to fix this. You're my hope. And so you go to prayer. So he goes to prayer in the second half right here. So here's where he prays. Here I am, now here I pray. And he says, I cried out to you, Lord, and I said, you are my refuge. Whoa. And I think to a very large extent, he's telling himself this. In the midst of, you know, it looks like the cave is the refuge, and it is in a physical reality. But what he's saying is, no, wait, I got to stop myself. This is not my refuge. God's my refuge. And by the way, the refuge from an ancient idea is a place where you could run to that you would be protected from the people pursuing you. They actually had places called cities of refuge. You could run to in case you accidentally killed somebody. And you think, oh, I'm innocent, but you know, the relatives of the person I accidentally killed are going to come and kill me on the spot. I'm going to run to the city of refuge. Oh, and there were a handful of these in Israel. Run to the city of refuge, and there you would be protected until everyone had calmed down. You could work out the justice of it all. So there was a city of refuge. He says, you are the one I run to that protects me from the people who are pursuing. Not this cave. You, God, are my refuge. And that's a... That is such a perfect thing. He moves the entire context of the debate in his mind from the circumstance of my defenselessness to the spiritual nature where God says, I will be your protector. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. You got to remember that. You're my refuge. And so he brings that to mind first. He doesn't say, he doesn't appeal to God with his supplication first. He just states the truth. Says, God, okay, I'm saying it to you in your face right now. You're my refuge. And you're my portion in the land of the living. Again, a phrase we don't really use, portion. But portion is portion. You know, Thanksgiving dinner? You know, you got all that turkey and you got the cranberry sauce and all that kind of stuff. And I remember as a kid, you know, you'd cut into the turkey and you'd plop stuff on the plate and my dad would kind of serve us all and the plates would go around. And you'd look at that and he'd say, okay, that's your portion. That's what you get. That's what you get right now. Well, the table's full of lots of food, but that's your portion. And in a way, it's him saying, that's enough for you. That's what you get along with everyone else. And if I would whine because my brother's got more, he'd say, stop it. That's your portion. That's their portion. Just stop it. That's your portion. That's what you get. So really, it's a statement of what's necessary for you. Out of a large, huge amount of resource, your portion is what you've been given. And that's yours. And it's sufficient and it's necessary, but that's it. That's all you need. You don't really need anything else outside of that. So when you hear in the Old Testament them calling God their portion, he's saying in a longer sentence, God, you are all I need that's necessary and that's sufficient. And you are my sufficiency. So it's really a way of saying you're my sufficiency. You're all I need. I don't need anything else. I don't need these guys on the right hand who have all the swords. God, you're my portion. You're all I need. Now, when you're in the midst of the worst and darkest situation in life, it's very hard to say this because you clearly need more than that. You need a lot of other stuff. It's very clear. But you've already told God what those things are. You've already told him what your needs are in specific detail. He knows. He sees. He understands where you walk. He gets that. He's not clueless about your circumstance. But at this point, what your heart is saying, I put everything in your hands. You are my sufficiency for this. I'll wait for you. Let me show you a couple other places where it's used. Back in Deuteronomy 10:9, when they were splitting up the land of Israel as they came in, he says in Deuteronomy 10:9, therefore Levi, one of the tribes, does not have a portion or an inheritance with his brothers. The Lord is his inheritance, just as the Lord your God spoke to him. And if you remember your Old Testament history, when Israel came into the land, they left Egypt, a whole generation dies in the desert, Joshua finally brings them into the land, and they subdivide the land and where the tribes are going to live. And God says, everyone gets a chunk of the land except the tribe of Levi. Out of the 12 tribes, one of them doesn't get a chunk of land. And then you ask yourself, well, then how are they supposed to live? If you don't have a chunk of land, you can't grow wheat or barley. You can't raise animals. I mean, if you don't have a place, if you don't have land, you die is how that works. How is Levi as a tribe, an entire tribe, a 12th of the nation of Israel, how are they going to survive? And God says, the deal is Levi as a tribe has a special assignment from God. They're the ones that run the temple and the sacrifices, specifically Aaron and his priests. They have a specific job, and I don't want them tending fields. I want them tending the temple. Full-time job. Well, then how will they eat? You go back and you read the Old Testament. The sacrifices that were brought in were given to them. So the other 11 tribes would do sacrifices, and then the 12th tribe, Levi, got to eat those. Woo-hoo! Barbecue every day. Actually, yeah. So it's a pretty good deal. So their portion was not land. It was what? God himself. It was God himself was their portion. So that's all David is saying right here. He's saying, just like the priest tribe, my portion, my necessity, all I need, God, is you, and you will provide for me. So the tribe of Levi had to constantly trust that God was going to provide for them because they couldn't go out and dig dirt and grow wheat. Will God provide for us today? Yeah, and he will continue to provide for us. So it's really an active sense of trust as well. God, you're my portion right now. Now, you also have to think about this, the fact that God not only is your portion for eternity in heaven, but like right now. Like right now. Look at this verse. Psalm 27:13. I would have despaired unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. So wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Yes, wait for the Lord. I would have despaired if I didn't believe that God would be my goodness right now in the land of the living. Right now. Can God deliver you from your troubles right now? Yes, he will. Is he near to you right now? Yes, he is. If you call on his name, he's there. And if I didn't believe that, I would have despaired. if I didn't understand and embrace the fact that God's goodness visits me in the land of the living before I die. I love that verse. I've gone to that verse many times. God doesn't just say, well, get through this horrible thing you're going through, and you know, when you die, everything will be great, so quit whining. And he doesn't do that. I mean, it will be great then. There will be no sin, there'll be no suffering, there'll be no tears. It'll be a great time. But he also says, even now, and I would have despaired if I had forgotten the fact that his goodness comes to me in the land of the living as well. So that's why we pray. Our prayer isn't just an arbitrary hopefulness that I hope someone up there hears us. As a kid, I always wondered about how could God process so many prayers simultaneously? Billions of people praying at the same time. And I envisioned this gigantic switchboard in heaven, you know, with all these switchboard operators and people calling into God, and the line's getting really clogged like in a telethon, you know, operators are free. Oh, no, they're not, you know, and then the whole switchboard would get clogged. And how can God possibly hear all of our prayers? Well, he can, because it's not a switchboard in heaven. He's near you right now. And in fact, in the Old Testament, it says he inclines his ear to you like a parent leaning down, waiting to hear. And all you have to do is say, Lord, help me. He's right there. So I would have despaired unless I believed that I would see this goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. So wait for him. Wait for him. And that's exactly what David is doing. I'm waiting for the Lord. He'll change my circumstance. I'll be strong and take courage in him. So give heed to my cry, God. And why does he say give heed? Well, because I know you're my portion in the land of living. I know that you're intended for my best, even right now. So give heed to my cry, because listen, I am brought very low, very, very low. He continues to tell him his emotional state, even as he appeals to God to come and intercede on his behalf. He goes on, deliver me from my persecutors, for they're too strong for me. This is where your spirit is overwhelmed, but he's putting it in real terms too. He's saying, I can't do this. You need to deliver me from my persecutors, because you know what? They are many and strong. I am one and weak. So my only hope is you. By the way, he's also affirming the fact that David is bigger than all the armies. I mean, God is bigger than all the armies that all his enemies can muster. That's a pretty cool deal, because when you're in bad situations, many times we're tempted to believe that God's not big enough to handle this situation. God, the armies of all the bad that's coming after me right now, I don't know, God. I don't know if you're bigger than this. This would be like really big. Are you this big? And he's saying, oh, yeah, he's that big. He's that big. So when you have, this is the great news. This is why good news is so good. When you have a God that loves you so much, and that love is so immense, it's without dimension, and it's backed up with the resource of his power that's that big, then you've just struck the lottery. You've hit it big. You have someone who's on your side, the one who's on your right, who will engage on your behalf because of his loving kindness toward you, and he's got all the resources to engage. He could have said, I told you so, you got yourself into the mess, you made your bed, now lie in it, and quit whining. And he doesn't do that. And David also knows he can still appeal to God, even though David has been kind of an idiot in the previous week. That's a good point, so let's just emphasize that as well. If you're in a situation right now that's of your own doing, that's got you in a mess, that feels like there's no way out of it, God doesn't say you made your bed, lay in it. If you come to him and say, God, I'm in way over my head now. Will you help me? And he will. He will. He doesn't require a serial perfection of worthiness in your life before he engages and finally says, well, I think now you're worthy for me to help you. Because it was just a breath before, a week before in David's life, where he was lying to get his way to try and save himself. And that just did not work out well. So, yeah, they're too strong for me. No duh. Verse 7. So bring my soul out of prison so that I may give thanks to your name. He really sees this place, this cave that he's in, like a prison. That's why I showed it at the beginning. It's really, he's stuck. He's like under house arrest. He's got one of those yellow ankle bracelet things. He just can't get out. There's no way he can leave that place without dying. So he says, not only am I physically stuck in this prison of this cave, but my spirit's in prison well. I feel like everything about me to the deepest core of who I am is stuck, which is also what happens when we're in tough circumstances. The circumstance physically can be nasty, but what it does is it eats into your soul and into your spirit, and you feel like your soul is trapped, your spirit's trapped. There's no place I can go. It's the end for who I am even. So it's a very desperate internal struggle that goes on. He says, my spirit itself, my soul is in prison, but I want you to spring me out of the prison so I can give thanks to your name. And I want to emphasize that again because we'll see this over and over again. He gives thanks to his name. Why does he just give thanks to you, God? Spring me out of this prison that my soul's in, and I'll give thanks to you. I'm going to give thanks to your name. And in the Old Testament, every time you see this name, think reputation. Think reputation, you know? When Al Capone was in Chicago and visitors would come in, they'd say, do you know who Al Capone is? And they would say, yeah, he's got a real name around here. It's a reputation. Your name always reflects who you are in the ancient thinking. It's not just an arbitrary thing. You know, my first name is James. That doesn't mean anything about who I am. Should be idiot, actually, but it's James. But when you talk about the name of God, you're talking about the verbal representation of the character and nature and reputation of God himself. So what he's saying is, let's just draw that out. So if you do this for me, I'll give thanks and add one more thing to your reputation, I can tell people. That's what he's saying. So that later on in life, he can say, can I tell you who my God is like? This is his name. And you talk about his reputation and what he's done through your entire life. And let me add one more thing to that. There was a day where I was stuck in a cave and there wasn't a single soul on earth that was with me and I felt so alone. And God came near me and he was my refuge. And that's another piece of his name. See, that's what he's talking about. So when God does rescue from these things, he says, I'll add that to my list that I can tell other people. That's your reputation because this is what you've done. Again, every time that God comes to Israel in the Old Testament and Israel is doing bad stuff and God introduces his presence to them, he says to them his name. And what he does is he says, I'm the God who got you out of Egypt. Reputation. And if I'm the one who rescued you from Egypt, now I'm here to do similarly for good in your life. That's how he would tie it together. So the name, which is the reputation, is really his character based on how he's interceded for you. So he says, do this for me. And what I will do is I'll continue to give thanks to your reputation, to your name, who everyone knows you are. And the righteous, when I come out of this prison, will surround me, for you will deal bountifully with me. And that's what happens when you get out of prison. See, in prison, you're stuck. You're away from all your friends, unless they come and they visit on Saturdays, you know. He's saying, when you spring me from this prison, then I will finally be I'll be surrounded by the righteous, the people who honor and do good, rather than the Philistines down there who are all about doing me bad, and Saul's military who are all about doing me bad. When you spring me out of this place, I'll be surrounded by people who honor and revere good. That will be the day. Instead of looking to my right and seeing there's nobody there. That'd be a wonderful thing. And you'll deal bountifully with me, which means God won't just do a little bit to get you out. He'll go there and way more and way more. Yeah, and if you had an experience with God like this, when you're in the depths of one of these caves of life, what God doesn't do is just open up the opening the cave and push you out the front. He goes way over the top. You say, God, help me, and he takes away the negative and adds a ton of positive to your life. Many times that comes from what he does in changing your life in the midst of hard circumstances. You come out of the cave, which you never want to go back into, but when you come out of that cave of life and come out on the other side trusting God, you come out with something that's like a treasure. Partially what you understand about God and how you draw nearer to him. Your relationship with him is like a treasure, gets deeper. But something changes in you as well. There was something necessary that God allowed you to be in this cave of life that when he sprung you from it, you realized that you came out richer than when you went in. That's the bountifully. That's what David's saying. When you do this, I come out with so much more. It's not just reversing the negative trends of life. It's reversing the negatives and actually adding a ton of positive, bountiful, over the top. Fill my cup, over the top, overflowing. That's what he's saying. And I'll be surrounded by people who are righteous. And that's the end of the psalm. He speaks in the future tense, knowing what God will do on his behalf. You notice he started with present tense. This is how bad it is. I cry out to you. And in the end, he says, this is where it's going to go. You're going to deal bountifully with me. I'll be surrounded by the righteous. It'll be cool. Amen. Now listen. When you're in hard situations, do you ever pray at the end, say, it's all done, you've got it figured out, I can rest? Because if you don't, you're only going halfway in your prayers. You need to be able to say to him, you're my refuge. You're the one that delivers me from the ones who persecute me. You're the one who's my life itself. I've given myself to you, and because of what you've done in my past, delivering me from Egypt and all the other parts of my life, I now give and entrust myself to you, and you will do this based on your loving kindness and your loyalty and love for me. future tense, I'm done. And you thank him before you back out of the rest of the prayer. Very seldom do we get far enough in the prayer that we actually thank him for actually answering the prayer before it happens. But David does this on a routine schedule in the Psalms. Thanks for getting this done. Now, before we quit, there's a surprise in this story. Because I didn't read you the entire account in Adullam. Right after this, David departed from there, escaped to the cave of Adullam, did his prayer of Psalm 142. And when his brothers and all his family's household heard of it, they went down there to him. Everyone who was in distress, everyone who was in debt, everyone who was discontented gathered to him, and he became captain over them. And now there were about 400 men with him.
Sweet.
And God will surround me with the righteous. He did it. In reality, in the story, he did it. Here he is hiding out, worried for his life, saying, God, there's no one on my right who's engaging on my behalf but might. There's no one who even comes looking for me to care for me because they wonder, gee, where's David? Nobody's like that. And by the end of his prayer, they come to the front door of his cave. Isn't that astonishing? Isn't that astonishing? I mean, here's how it goes. I turned the map on its side so you can see it better. There's Jerusalem. David leaves Nob up there. He goes down to Gath where the Philistines are down there. He comes up through the Elah Valley where Goliath was to Adullam. And then as he's sitting there doing Psalm 142, 400 people hear about it. People who love him, people who look to him to be a leader, his entire family. And they say, we want to be with you. And David's prayer is literally answered in a heartbeat. Now tell me that's not cool. Because that's what God does. And yet, in the middle of our problems, we look to our right and it feels like there's nobody there. We look outside of our context and say, how comes no one's sending aid? Doesn't anybody care? How comes they're not looking in on me? I don't have anybody here, and I don't have anybody there. God, you're my refuge. You're my strength. Break me out of this jail, and you'll surround me with the righteous. But what God does in an interesting twist, not only does he bring the righteous to him, but he doesn't spring him out of the cave. What he does in a really clever way, God says, I don't have to spring you out of this cave to bless you with the people in your life. I can bless you while you're still in the midst of the cave. Now, there's big theology in this. You may be in a dark context of a cave in life, and you're praying about, God, change the context that's so dark with me. And God says, I can. But what I'm going to do first is I'm going to surround you with people who love you. And the cave gets less dark. And these friends who are engaged for your best say, don't forget, God's your refuge. He'll get you through this. It'll be okay. We're here. We love you. We came looking for you. Kind of a drab place you're in. But we love you so much, we want to be with you. And that's very much the role of the modern church in our lives. Because many of us find ourselves in caves. Literally caves of circumstance that tend to take our soul and bury them. It's so oppressive. And God surrounds you with the righteous who come and remind you about the loving kindness of God, who come around and say, we've never stopped caring about you. Where have you been? I see the cave you're in, but can I sit in this cave with you just to reassure you that God will get you through this? And that's exactly what the 400 did with David. They came to him. And not only did they come to him to love him, but the ones who were in desperate need of real godly leadership in the nation, which Saul was not providing, came to him and said, you're our captain. You're our captain. We want you to lead us through God's grace and what God wants for us. So in the midst of this worst circumstance, they're saying, you're our guy. We've always loved you. And we look to you because God has brought you to be a gift to us to lead us. You're ours. So it's a tremendous picture of what God does in the midst of your circumstance. That the circumstance itself, although it causes you to get depressed, God changes the circumstance, not by getting you out of the circumstance always, sometimes, but he starts with having people that he brings into the mouth of the cave. The interesting question in the story is, how do they know where he is? He's in hiding. If it's well known where he is, Saul's going to send his armies after him and just flood the mouth of the cave and kill him. If the Philistines know where he is, they're going to do the entire same thing. How did these people know where David was? We don't have the answer to that. But we do know that God heard his prayer, surround me with the righteous, and they found him. It could have been a miracle. And in parts of our lives where we find ourselves in those kinds of caves of existence, the people he brings to our door many times are a miracle. And I've seen that happen over and over and over again. How did they know to come and do this? They didn't even know where my spirit was. How did they know? And God orchestrates that, and he brings the righteous around, and they bring encouragement and support and a reminder that the circumstance is less important than the King who is your refuge. So one last point. Maybe God is asking you to be the people who go to the other person's cave. That can be really hard. I mean, many of us know the caves of depression circumstantially that people are in around us. We know it to some degree. Sometimes it's a complete mystery. But are you willing to be the people who basically leave home in a certain sense, that is the comfort of your existence, and say, I'm going to go into their cave with them, and I'll sit with them and remind them about the loving kindness of God? Oh, yeah. And Eric was at conference?
Yeah. I just was like, wow. And he sat there and just was pretty impressed. I feel like he's a pretty strong guy.
He's a pretty strong guy?
Going to a cave like that.
Yeah. So consider yourselves part of the 400. And even when you're in your own cave of problems, you can still be one of the 400 to somebody else. You don't have to say, well, God, I don't know. I'm not sure I'm really emotionally ready for this right now. I'm not sure I've got enough of my own problems to deal with. And God says, yeah, but you don't have a clue what they're dealing with. So listen to the Lord. He'll lead you. He'll perk you up. It's the wonderful thing about the body of Christ. The body of Christ is Christ himself in us, ministering within us to one another. He leads. The Holy Spirit gives you an idea. And this thing kind of happens. It's a remarkably encouraging thing that God does, but you may be one of the 400, even though you're still in kind of a small cave yourself. Yeah, Steve.
Yeah, it's like you said, go out and help somebody else, because God might be leading you to do that to help your circumstance.
To help your circumstance. Yeah, exactly. And
you never know with him.
And again, I'll probably quote this every time we read a song because it's so applicable, but at the beginning of 2 Corinthians, Paul says that you've been comforted by God. This is in the very first chapter, the very first couple of verses. You've been comforted by God so that you can be a comfort to somebody else. That's the purpose. So when things get right and things get nice and then say, well, I'm glad that's over, your assignment's just beginning, because you may be a 400 in someone else's life. That's the deal. Okay, let's quit. Father, what a remarkable story this is. What a remarkable psalm in the midst of this context. And Lord, many of us here, myself included, have been in some pretty dark caves of circumstance. There seems to be no light. There seems to be no escape. And our existence seems to be solitary and depressing. And Lord, we cry out to you. In our crying to you, you hear our voice. You remind us that you'll never leave us or forsake us. And you bring some of the most tremendous people into the circles of our life who we would never expect. And you draw them to us, and they speak truth about you. And our downcast eyes are lifted up once again, and we understand that there's nothing in our path that you don't see. There's nothing in our circumstance that you have slept through that surprises you. And Lord, you bring great encouragement through those who already know you, who understand your loving kindness, who understand your name and your reputation. God, I pray that you would deliver us from our dark caves if we have them right now. But more than that, that you would use us as one of these 400, that you'd use us by your direction and by your Spirit's unique gifting, that you would use us in the lives of others to remind them that in the darkest places they find themselves, there's still hope in you, and there's still a God that loves, and there's still a God that sees, and there's still a God whose love is so limitless that is backed up by the power and reputation of the entire universe engaged on our behalf. Because, Lord, if you've given your Son for our benefit, what are you going to hold back now, really? So thank you for your great loving kindness to us, and cause our eyes to look out for the little lights coming out of the caves that people are suffering in right next door to us, that we might be a light and that we might be a word of encouragement about the great God who always has been and will be our refuge in times of trouble. So thank you for all this in Jesus' name. Amen.